Good evening, everyone. Good evening. And thank you, everyone, for coming this evening to talk about the Lake Okeechobee Watershed Project. My name is David Tipple. I am the Deputy Chief of Planning and Policy Division with the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers Jacksonville District, and I will be presiding over tonight's public meeting for the Lake Okeechobee Watershed Project. We are aware that there is a lot of interest in what we're doing with Everglades restoration and how it is being implemented. I'd like to assure you that we understand your concerns. Through projects such as the Lake Okeechobee Watershed Project, we are working to increase storage and operational flexibility within the system. This will help provide some relief to the estuaries. The Lake Okeechobee Watershed Project is an Everglades restoration planning effort that aims to improve the quantity, quality, timing, and distribution of water entering Lake Okeechobee. The objectives of this project are to improve system-wide operational flexibility, reduce undesirable releases to the Caloosahatchee and St. Lucie estuaries downstream of the lake, improve the quality of water entering Lake Okeechobee, and restore isolated wetlands in the watershed. This is the first of many meetings that will provide the opportunity for public input into the development of the Lake Okeechobee Watershed Project. We are here tonight to provide information and ask for your input on the National Environmental Policy Act assessment for the project. Before we begin, I would like to thank you for all of you taking time out of your busy schedules to get involved in the planning process. I would also like to recognize and thank the following individuals: Florida State Representative Heather Fitzenhagen, Commissioner Terry Burrows, and Commissioner Brian Culpepper of Okeechobee County, City Councilman Dowling Watford, Commissioner Molly Soto Gardner of the City of Lewiston, Commissioner Carson Turner from Henry County, and Sherry McCorkle from Congressman Rooney's office. Thank you very much for attending the meeting tonight. This meeting is being held in accordance with the National Environmental Policy Act for the sole purpose of listening to you. I would like to remind you of the importance of filling out these cards that were available at the check-in table. These cards serve two purposes. First, they let us know that you're interested in this project so we can help keep you informed. And second, to provide me with a list of individuals who wish to speak tonight. If you did not fill out a card, they are available again over at the registration table where you came in. So let me see if I can get this to move forward. So, all right, let's give that a shot. Before we begin the presentation, let me introduce the project delivery team that's here with me tonight. From the Corps of Engineers, Jeff Couch, our Ecosystem Branch Chief, Tim Geisen, the Corps' Project Manager on this study, Lisa Ailey, Planning Technical Lead, Dr. Gretchen Ellinger, Environmental Lead, Rick McMillan, Operations Division, Jim Riley, Environmental Engineer, Kim Taplin, Program Manager, Dave Apple, Watershed Section Chief and Planning Division, and Jen Miller and Erica Sculte from our Corporate Communications Office. And from the South Florida Water Management District, our cost share partner, Matt Morrison, Federal Policy and Coordination Chief, Leslie Burton-Alati, Lake Okeechobee Watershed Project Manager, Jennifer Leeds, Federal Restoration Planning and Coordination Unit Leader, Libby Maxwell, Senior Regional Representative for the Okeechobee Region, Peter Doring, Coastal Ecosystem Section Administrator, Megan and Jacoby, Project Manager for the Western Everglades Restoration Project, and Armando Ramirez, Tribal and Federal Affairs Liaison. In a few minutes, I'll turn the floor over to Matt Morrison, Lisa Ailey, and Dr. Ellinger, who will provide you with a brief overview of the project and planning process. Once the presentation is complete, I will then open the meeting to public comments, and to ensure everyone gets a chance to provide their comments, I will ask that you all hold your comments and input until the end of the presentation. And again, we're going to run two mere presentations and public comment periods. This one starting at 6:30 till 7:30, and then a second 7:30 to 8:30 due to the wonderful interest that you've expressed in this project. So with that, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce Matt Morrison.
Just quickly on the overhead, that's the agenda for today's meeting. We just got through the welcome and introductions. I'm Matt Morrison with the South Florida Water Management District. I'm going to provide a quick and brief overview of the Everglades Restoration Program that the South Florida Water Management District works in consultation and coordination with the Army Corps of Engineers out of the Jacksonville District. And then we'll take some time to talk about the Lake Okeechobee Watershed itself and kind of a project overview, if you will. And then the Corps will go into the actual National Environmental Policy Act and the requirements that are there, and then we'll talk about the schedule for this planning project as we move forward and develop a project plan that at the end of the day we'll put together and send up to Congress for their approval and appropriations for funding so we can actually build storage north of the lake. And then at the end, of course, as mentioned by the previous introductory comments, we will be taking the public comment. So with that said, I'm going to jump to this slide real quick, and I'm going to talk a little bit about the Comprehensive Everglades Restoration Program. There's an overhead slide here that shows three different cartoon depictions of the 16 counties that the South Florida Water Management District operates and maintains. On the far left is a representation of what the greater Everglades system really looked like before humans were introduced into the environment, recognizing that north of the lake, when rainfall hit, it was collected in what we now call the upper chain of lakes. That water moved south through the central part of the state into Lake Okeechobee, and as that water rained and moved into the lake, those lake levels came up naturally and then basically overspilled south into what we call the River of Grass or the Greater Everglades System on down to Florida Bay. Now, with that said, over the last 100 years, in order for all of us to live and thrive here in South Florida and enjoy the beautiful weather that we have, the system has been modified fairly extensively with a series of canal networks. There is a dike around Lake Okeechobee to protect residents around the lake and to allow us better management opportunities of water that comes into the system. And there are a series of canal networks that are south of the lake that provide flood control for agricultural operations and the developed community in the cities that we live in along the lower east coast. So the way the system operates today is much different than it was before humans were introduced into South Florida. The rainfall is collected in the upper chain of lakes. It still moves down the system into Lake Okeechobee, but it moves down the system much quicker than it did historically. And since we have a compartmentalized, channelized system south of the lake, we don't have the ability to move water the way it did historically, and today we move some of those flood control releases out to the northern estuaries as undesirable regulatory discharges. So the future flow on the right is really a graphical representation of implementation of the Comprehensive Everglades Restoration Plan, where we're looking at better managing the lake, better managing the hydrology in the system, and being able to reduce those undesirable discharges to the northern estuaries and being able to move more water through the central portion of the Everglades on down to Florida Bay. So CERP in general, the Comprehensive Everglades Restoration Plan, was developed back in 1999 under a comprehensive review study. And in that document, it contained 68 different project components that were identified to improve the environmental conditions in the South Florida ecosystem. And with those 68 components, it acknowledged that it was a pretty big task to implement those projects that were identified, and it could take as long as 30 years to actually do the planning, do the design, get the funding, and then actually construct the projects and make them operational. So in the restudy that I mentioned from back in 1999, that's kind of the framework for which we move forward and plan. The Lake Okeechobee Watershed Project is one of those 68 components in the comprehensive review study. In the review study itself, it included a number of different features that would be placed on the landscape over time to improve ecological conditions, and they're listed there. There's aquifer storage and recovery. That is basically utilizing a well system where you capture excess runoff from the landscape. You move that water into the upper portion of the Florida aquifer when water is plentiful, and then when times are drier, you bring that water back up, you put it back in the regional system for environmental purposes. So that was one mechanism for storage that was identified in the restudy to help improve the South Florida environmental system. In addition to that, there were surface water storage reservoirs. And between the ASR systems and the surface water storage reservoirs, those will really be the two different type of project components that the project team members formulating the Lake Okeechobee Watershed Project will be looking at. We really want to be able to place storage reservoirs north of the lake, coupled with ASR technology, aquifer storage technology, to improve the storage that we have north of the lake for operational flexibility and reducing the undesirable discharges to the northern estuaries. In addition to that, there were a series of other management measures, stormwater treatment areas for improving water quality. There were some seepage management features, in particular along the lower east coast of Florida, recognizing that as we move more water into the central portion of the greater Everglades system, we would have to control seepage to make sure that the developed areas to the east were protected. And then we have a very compartmentalized system today as a result of the canals and the impoundments and the levees. And really, in order to move more water south the way it did historically, we have to remove those barriers to flow. So those were identified as well. So combining a series of these different management measures or components are really, over the long term, are the solution for improving the hydrologic conditions in the greater Everglades system. And as they come online over time and they're built and they become operational, there was also an acknowledgement in the last bullet there that we would be revising the way that we operate the surface water management system in South Florida, because as these additional facilities come online, they do different things. We revise operations to accommodate those new features and improve the way that we actually operate the system as a whole. So where are we today? I thought it was important just to give a quick overview of the progress that's been made to date in the Everglades Restoration Program, the South Florida Ecosystem Restoration Program that we've all been working on since 1999. Up in the top are what we call the pre-comprehensive Everglades Restoration Projects. They're known as our foundation projects. Those are the ones that predated the Comprehensive Everglades Restoration Plan itself, and they include Kissimmee River Restoration, where we're working with the Army Corps to eliminate the channelization in the portion of the Kissimmee River and restore the natural oxbows north of the lake, which improves storage and water quality for water that comes from the upper watersheds into Lake Okeechobee. We've made significant progress on that over the last 20 years, and that project is expected to be complete in the next 4 years. In addition to that, down in the southeast part of the system, we have what are called modified water deliveries in the C-111 South Dade Project. Those are projects along the East Coast Protective Levee, adjacent to Everglades National Park, that are also nearing completion, and those facilities are really designed to hold the new water, the additional flows that come into the Everglades system, in the natural system and prevent that water from seeping out into the developed areas. And in order to move more water through the system into Everglades National Park, we have to be able to provide those seepage management features, and those two projects are foundation projects because they need to take place before we move more water south. And then we get into what we call the first, second generation SERP projects. The first generation projects were approved by Congress in 2007. We have a Malaleuca eradication facility. I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about that one or the Bethune Strand project that are either completed or under construction, but I am going to focus on the IRL South project, where we have a C-44 reservoir and stormwater treatment area that are currently under construction on the St. Lucie River that will provide storage and treatment for water that comes from Lake Okeechobee before it actually enters the estuary in the Indian River Lagoon. And then the second generation projects, that was the last suite of project implementation reports that Congress authorized in 2014. They're listed there. Again, I'm going to kind of focus on the C43 reservoir. It's very similar to the C44 reservoir on the Caloosahatchee, but the St. Lucie, the C43 is on the Caloosahatchee River. We just initiated construction of that reservoir this year, and that'll be a reservoir that'll be on the Caloosahatchee River that will help store water that comes from Lake Okeechobee and then return that water to the Caloosahatchee estuary when it's needed. So again, two big projects on the East Coast and West Coast that are going to help reduce some of the undesirable discharges to the northern estuaries. And then the last set here, really kind of the completed or active planning studies. We have the Central Everglades Planning Project that was finished in 2014 that is now teed up for congressional authorization. That is a project that took about 3.5 years to formulate, and that is the project that provides the additional storage south of the lake and decompartmentalizes that system south of the lake to allow us to actually move water from Lake Okeechobee south into the greater Everglades system. So in a nutshell, a lot of the foundation projects that are required are nearing completion. The big storage reservoirs to the east and the west are under construction, and we're really just waiting for Congress to approve and appropriate the Central Everglades Planning Project that has storage features south of the lake. So really, what's next? Whoops, what'd I do? There we go. So really, to help us identify from a planning perspective what is next on the horizon, we turn to what we call the integrated delivery schedule. And I saw a number of people carrying that around when they walked in the room today. If you look at the color coding here, the color on the top are those foundation projects. The green ones are the Gen 1. The purple ones are the Gen 2 projects. And if you go all the way to the bottom, those are the planning projects that we're initiating now, one of which is the Lake Okeechobee Watershed and ASR project that we're here tonight to kind of kick off. I think it's important to recognize that the sequencing for the implementation of these projects is very important and has been based on a lot of technical information. And really, why are we looking at storage north of the lake as the next planning effort? And there's a number of reasons that we're doing that. One, I mentioned earlier, we have big storage reservoirs on the east and the west, and we have the Central Everglades Planning Project that is going to open up the southern end of the system to provide storage south of the lake. But just as importantly, the Water Institute at the University of Florida did a comprehensive review of our program, the South Florida Ecosystem Restoration Program, and made it pretty clear in that report that if you're really going to move forward and reduce the damaging discharges to the northern estuaries, you need to have storage north of the lake. So with the storage that's being constructed to the east and the west, and the storage that's associated with the Central Everglades Planning Project, acknowledging that if you really want to take a dent out of the undesirable discharges to the northern estuaries, you really need to start focusing on storage north of the lake. And that's why it's sequenced like that, and that's why we're here today to talk to you about this project plan and expediting the planning effort to completion. So just on this overhead, just a quick overview of the planning boundary. You'll see the slide again in the presentation. I don't want to spend a lot of time on this other than to let everybody know that there are a number of tributaries that are north of Lake Okeechobee in these colored sub-basins that bring water into Lake Okeechobee. And as part of this planning project, we'll be looking at these individual colored sub-basins in identifying the most cost-effective, beneficial storage options that will help capture some of that water that moves very quickly down the system from the upper watershed and intercept it and store it before it makes its way to the lake. And then when we put that water aside in storage, it will also allow us to take that water that's been stored and return it to the lake when we're in drought conditions or dry conditions when the lake is low. So that's kind of an overview of the program. And I would just like to personally thank everybody for coming. We're really looking forward to launching this effort, and There'll be a lot of public input as we move forward. In addition to the meetings that the Army Corps will be scheduling, we'll be giving regular updates at our Water Resources Advisory Committee at the South Florida Water Management District, as well as our governing board. So please stay tuned to our website, the Jacksonville District's website, as we move forward during this very important planning effort. So thank you very much.
Everyone, my name is Lisa Ailey. I am the planning technical lead for this project, and I'll provide just a brief overview of the study area and what the purpose and objectives of this project are. So the primary purpose of the Lake Okeechobee Watershed Project is to improve the quality, quantity, timing, and duration of water entering Lake Okeechobee. We're also looking at some ecosystem restoration opportunities within the project area. Yes. Everyone can hear me now? So this map here shows an overview of where the project area is within the Lake Okeechobee boundary. The Lake Okeechobee watershed drains south from Orlando into the Everglades. Water flows into the lake primarily through the Kissimmee River, Fish Eating Creek, and Taylor Creek Nub and Slough, and then flows out to the east through the St. Lucie Canal into the St. Lucie Estuary, and out to the west through the Caloosahatchee River out to the Caloosahatchee Estuary, and then south through four major canals into the Everglades Agricultural Area and then into the water conservation areas. So one of our primary challenges in operating Lake Okeechobee is that it fills up in storm events sometimes six times quicker than we can release the water. So the Corps operates Lake Okeechobee through the LORS, the Lake Okeechobee Regulation Schedule, and we strive to keep the lake between 12.5 and 15.5 feet. But because of this operational challenge, and also because the conveyance capacity to the estuaries is much greater than down south, occasionally we do have to make releases down to the estuaries during flood events. So here's the project area. It consists of Fish Eating Creek, Indian Prairie, the S65 D&E, and Taylor Creek Nub and Slough sub-watersheds. When I say the project boundary, I mean that would be the area that we would potentially place project features. The study boundary, where we would look at potential impacts or benefits, is within that project boundary, the lake and the estuaries as well. So there are a lot of problems that we've been going through and working with other agencies to identify the primary problems. Over time, the spatial extent of wetlands has degraded in the project area due to conversions of land to agriculture, industrial uses, and drainage and channelization, which has led to a substantial reduction in the extent of the wetlands and estuaries, meaning that also the historic water holding capacity and filtration capacity has been decreased, which has set off a whole slew of other problems in the area. So led to degraded water quality in Lake Okeechobee within the watershed and also in the estuaries. The inflows to Okeechobee greatly exceed the outflow capacity, making water management challenging. There are extreme high and low water levels in Okeechobee. Those high water levels harm the littoral zone, but the low water levels can lead to the spread of invasives and exotics in the project area. We have undesirable high volume discharges to the Caloosahatchee and St. Lucie estuaries. And as I mentioned earlier, there's a substantial reduction in the spatial extent of wetlands. And all of this has damaging effects to wildlife and threatened and endangered species. So we've identified some opportunities that this project can potentially address. So there's an opportunity to improve system-wide operational flexibility. If we create additional storage north of the lake, that helps with our flexibility and water management. We could improve the water quality of the quality of water entering Lake Okeechobee. We would like to reconnect and restore fragmented wetlands. There would be some potential ancillary water supply and flood control benefits. We're hoping to increase or improve existing recreational opportunities. And also, we would like to coordinate with other agencies on ongoing restoration activities in the watershed. So we're not working in a bubble. We're looking with other agencies to see what they're doing and how can we add onto the projects that they're doing. Our project's objectives, so what we would like to do with this project. We would like to reduce the undesirable discharges from the lake to the estuaries. We would like to improve the quality, quantity, timing, and duration of water entering Lake Okeechobee. We want to improve the system-wide operational flexibility, and we would also like to restore wetlands in the project area. So our constraints, what we want to avoid, we do not want to affect existing water supply or flood protection benefits. We want to avoid any sort of impacts to cultural, historic, and archaeological resources. We will follow applicable laws, regulations, and standards. We want to maintain existing navigability throughout the lake and throughout the watershed. And we want to work within the existing flexibility of LORS, the Lake Okeechobee regulation schedule. So we will not be updating that as part of this study. So with that, I would like to introduce Dr. Gretchen Eilinger, who will go over the NEPA process.
Thank you and good evening. I'm gonna go over the reason we are here. We are here because this is the part of the National Environmental Policy Act scoping meeting, so NEPA. And so NEPA is a federal law that requires consultation with the public. It requires us to present to you any federal project that's gonna have a significant impact on the environment and or proposed potential impact to the environment, and provided an opportunity for the public, for stakeholders, for agencies, for tribes, and local governments to provide input on any project that we're gonna be doing. So for the Lake Okeechobee Watershed Project, we are looking to, in the scoping area, in the scoping meeting, get your input on the purpose, objectives, and all this is gonna be taken into consideration as the project moves forward. So the NEPA process begins with determining how much of an impact you're gonna have. For projects that are gonna have a cumulative, no significant impact, you would go to a categorical exclusion. However, when there is more significant effects, you go into an environmental assessment, or if you're gonna, you know we're gonna have significant impacts, either positive or negative, you go through an environmental impact statement. So we will be preparing an environmental impact statement for the Lake Okeechobee Watershed Project. And the very first part of this project starts with the scoping process. And through the scoping process, we're gonna be getting input from the public, and it will factor into the formulation of the project and the array of alternatives. And then it will result in the drafting of an environmental impact statement. And this environmental impact statement is going to analyze all of the environmental effects of the project, and as well as the no action alternative, or you know, if we do not do this project. Now the Corps has a 6-step planning process, and this coincides with the NEPA process as well. Right now in step one, we're at the very start of the study, we are looking at the problems, opportunities, the goals and objectives of this study, and that fits in with the NEPA part of it, which is the purpose and need. And then the second step is looking at your existing conditions and forecasting future conditions with the project. And that looks, on the NEPA side, is your affected environment as well as your no action. If you don't do the project, what are the effects? And then step three is developing alternatives. Since this is an ecosystem restoration project, we're looking at developing alternatives that provide the best ecosystem restoration benefits for the least cost. So we're looking at developing an array of alternatives, looking that to give us the most lift or the most environmental benefits in this project area. And that is equivalent to the range of alternatives for the NEPA process. And then we need to evaluate those plans. We're going to be analyzing everything from water quality, that are endangered species, hydrology, cultural resources, air quality, noise, aesthetics, all those factors, environmental factors. We'll be analyzing those plans, and we'll be comparing those plans and then selecting a final rate alternatives and a preferred plan that gives us the most environmental benefits. And so through that full NEPA assessment, through the six-step planning process, we follow along with the NEPA assessment, which will get us to an environmental impact statement at the end. And the Corps, through the six-step planning process, develops a project implementation report. And so the final product is going to be an integrated project implementation report and environmental impact statement. The Corps planning process has changed recently. We've listened to the, we've been hearing that the process for Corps planning takes too long and it costs too much money. So we have switched to a 3x3x3 planning process, which means no more than 3 years to plan a project, no more than $3 million, and it has to go through three levels of core review, which makes it more an efficient process. And it's a decision-based process, so as decisions are made, they're approved and the project is moving forward, so hopefully this planning process can be done faster. And it identifies the risk and uncertainty as each step as we go along. So identify, we don't have all the data that we need, but we're gonna, focus our resources on the data that's required to reduce certain risks and then move on. And so through this process, the report is developed as we go through the planning process. So what's important for you in this process is that we are at the very beginning. We are at the NEPA scoping process, the red arrow. And what this means is that we have the scoping period and we have extended the comment period to August 12th. It's on a future slide, just wanted to let you know that we have extended that. And so by the 18th of October, we have our first milestone of developing the alternatives. So it's a very fast process, so we want your input as soon as possible so that can be incorporated into alternatives. Our alternatives, what we're proposing, will be our group of projects or our group of management measures for this project. So once we have our alternatives, then we're going to select our preferred plan or our TSP, our tentatively selected plan, and that is where we will draft the environmental impact statement. And once we have the draft environmental impact statement, that will go out for public review, so you'll have a chance to review that document. It'll be integrated with our project implementation report, and that will go out for a 45-day public and agency comment period. We will then incorporate those changes, and then there will be a final environmental impact statement that will get sent out again for a 30-day review period. And then once that is approved, goes through our agency reviews, and eventually you end up with a finalized environmental impact statement, project implementation report, and get sent up through the Corps chain to get a record of decision. And then assigned record of decision will be at the end of the process. This is a 18 to 36 month process, so it's a quick one. And so the public participation starts today with the scoping meeting. We have comment cards. We have you're able to make public comment here. We do have scoping comment cards that you're more than welcome to draw. Where you think you want project features, what you want included, where you think water should flow. Feel free to draw on these, leave them here with us, or mail them in. You can send emails in, you can make a public comment tonight. There's other meetings, our project delivery team meetings. We'll be open to the public in terms of providing feedback and providing comments. We have the South Florida Ecosystem Restoration Task Force meetings. There's working group meetings, science coordination group meetings. We'll have additional NEPA meetings when we have the draft environmental impact statement. You have the Water Resources Advisory Commission meetings. You have governing board meetings, other CERP meetings. So there's a whole lot of opportunities for the public to be engaged and to provide your input, which we highly value. We look at every single comment we receive. They're included in comment matrices. You'll get a response for all the comments that we do receive. So, as I said, we have extended our scoping comment period through till August 12th, so feel free to send emails. The email is up there. You can mail comments to me, and I highly recommend if you have specific things that you want, and it's easier to do on a map, to please write all over this, right on the back. you know, do whatever you want with it and send it to us and we'll enter it into the public record. All this information, this presentation, as well as the posters, are posted on the webpage, which is listed down there. And written comments, email comments, and comments that you say that when you are here at these meetings all have the same weight, and we, you know, we reply to all of those. So with that, I'm going to turn it back over to Dave.
Okay, everyone, I'm probably going to reinforce a few things that that Gretchen just laid out to you, but in my opening comments, I talked about opportunities for operational flexibility as we're looking at restoration opportunities within the system. So I'm asking you to work with us to have some operational flexibility for our public meeting. We have quite a few people out there waiting, very warm, and we have 44 comment cards asking a few that are in the room to wanting to express some comments, and that doesn't include people that have expressed that they'd like to make comments as well. So I'm going to ask for you to go with me on a little flexibility here, that we are not going to do a second formal presentation for the sake of time, and looking at those folks that are in the room that want to make comments and provide that input at the microphone here, as well as allowing, I'm asking if for those folks that are in the room that don't wish to make any comments, to consider allowing those that are waiting outside to come in, and we can do a little metering. We've got some people that are kind of, as people come out, people be allowed in to give those comments. And as Gretchen mentioned, there's an opportunity, one, to provide comments via the email as well as formal written comments through August 12th, but also one of our team members from the Corps is videotaping this public forum, and also we're having a transcript, and both of those things, the video as well as the transcript, will be available as well as the PowerPoint presentation. So if you miss anything, or if the folks, you know, that are out there that didn't see the presentation, they will have an opportunity to view the video as well as see the presentation, as well as look through the transcript. So I'd ask for your consideration there. But at this time, we're going to, again, it's warmer here, I know. It's warmer out there. But you are extremely important to the process, and it's extremely important for your voices to be heard. And so we're here to listen to your comments, to understand your concerns, and to provide you, again, with this opportunity for input with your opinions on the record, should you care to do so. So again, the transcript of this public meeting will be prepared, and the record will remain open until August 12th, and then written comments may be submitted to the email address here on the slide, and the mailing address also shown. So with that said, individuals speaking tonight, again, 44 of cards submitted that would like to say something in this room alone, with more outside, will be called to the microphone. So I guess we need to make sure the microphone's in the right spot. Okay, and so please come forward to the microphone as I call your name and state your name, and if applicable, what organization you represent. And given the number of cards we have, and some more coming our way, I ask that you keep your comments pertinent to the Lake Okeechobee Watershed project, such as the project area, constraints, management measures. I'm asking, can you say what you want to say in 2 minutes, if you can, given the fact that you can submit written comments, given the number of cards and opportunities for others to come in and out. Again, ask you to consider, if you're not making a comment, would you mind making a spot available, because the capacity of this room is what we're dealing with, and some ebb and flow of people would be much appreciated. So again, also, after the formal comments, if you all are so on, want to have some one-on-one dialogue with some of the team members, talk about a few specific things on the Lake Okeechobee Watershed Project or related things, they'll be around the poster boards that are around, and glad to engage with you. So again, thank you for your time and commitment to being here. So with that said, I'm going to go to the first individual on the card. So again, step forward and say your name, and if you're with an organization, please state that organization that you represent. Ramon Iglesias.
Raymond Iglesias from Lamont Marina, Clemson, Florida. We're in support of this program. We just wish that 333 might turn into a 111. It's been a big issue for many years. It's important that we clean the water before it leaves Lake Okeechobee. So storing it north of the lake is what we need and what we're looking forward to. So if you can maybe speed up the progress, I don't know how you do that in the political season. Everybody wants to get involved, but it's time to move it forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Ramon. I believe the card says Captain Don Voss. Again, your name and your affiliation, if you're with an organization.
Captain Don Voss, One Florida Foundation. I appreciate that we're looking at cleaning the water before it gets to Lake Okeechobee and comes to our estuaries. I appreciate that you're slowing down the water. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Paul Carlisle.
Hi, Paul Carlisle, County Administrator for Glades County, Florida. We're one of the two counties that the Corps is looking at to develop this watershed. We would ask the Corps a few items. One is, could you expand that program further up the chain of lakes to capture the water that's coming out of the Orlando area that is affecting the lake? And if you're going to utilize lands that the state already owns first before you start taking more lands off our tax roll. It's very important to us. When you start taking lands off the tax roll, it's jobs. We cannot bankrupt the internal counties because of what has happened in the coastal and in the Orlando region. So work with us, we'll work with you all. We all know that clean water is good for the entire state. So if you're going to take more lands off the tax roll in our counties, please compensate us for it. If it's good for the entire state, we should be compensated, and we should look at lands outside of this area, and we should look at lands regulating where development goes as they encroach from the urban areas into the agricultural area and their discharges that they put into those watersheds. Thank you.
Thank you. Newton Cook.
Thank you. This is a great presentation, and I spoke with a couple of people before I got up here, and I want to be real quick. Number one, we've been through this rodeo once before. The reason we can raise water in the semi-chain is that the district has already purchased the easements on the land. For a number of years ago, we were going to raise it 2 feet for the very same purpose, to hold it back, keep it out of the lake, and to clean the water. Unfortunately, a storm came along called Fay. The Corps decided that if they had had 2 feet extra water through the system, downtowns and most of the cities along the city chain of lake would have flooded. So that has kind of gone away. And now it's come back, and it's a very good thing, but we have to remember there's consequences when we start holding and moving water. But back in those days, 10 years ago, Lake Okeechobee Rack, we asked the Corps a question, how many acre feet new would be stored when we raise this system? And I spoke with Lisa and the folks here today, and the number is right at about the same. It's 295,000, let's say 300,000 acre feet will be new storage. And this is for you folks in the estuaries, because you hear me say all the time, please tell these people the truth. That's 8 inches off the lake. It's nothing. The lake today is 20 inches too high. 8 inches would have been gone in January. This is a very good project. It's very important, but it's not going to help the estuaries that much. The second problem that's coming up is the Endangered Species Act. The snail kite is suddenly becoming much more popular among the endangered species for folks. And if the snail kite stops the movement of the water up and down in the KCOL, like the Cape Sable Seaside Sparrow has stopped the movement under the Tamiami Trail, then you folks in the estuaries will be bombed every time there's a rainstorm and the snail kites are nesting and they can't build their nest. There are two very crucial things happening here. There is no way to move water south. The bottom of the lake, max 4 to 6 thousand CFS. That's all that can go out of the bottom. Coming in just this last January, 18,000 CFS. Why do you think it goes out to estuaries? There's only three ways it can go, C-43, C-44, south of Florida Bay. You cannot send it south today. There is no structure at the bottom of the lake that will do 18,000 CFS. There's no flowway to get it to the Tamiami Trail, and if you had it, guess what? It's dead stop because of the Cape Sable Sea Stout Scare. Thank you.
Thank you. Again, all comments will receive equal consideration. Again, state your name, and if you have an affiliation, please state that. Next gentleman is Hugh, and I apologize if I get this wrong. Harley Inc.
Thank you. My name is Hugh Harley, and I'm with the East Central Florida Regional Planning Council, and we would like to see the effort moved further to the north so that it includes the area that is draining into the lake itself. We would also work with the counties and cities that are involved around the lake, and one of the things that we think would be very helpful would be if the counties and DOT would set up check dams in their ditch sections so that they would hold the water back and then discharge it. Those type of dams are used all over the state of Florida, and if you were able to hold 6 inches of water back in the upland areas over the time period that we're talking about, a lot of the controls that you're looking for would be helped significantly. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, the next person is Maria Bolton Hubert, and also to have the cue, if Chris Nolan could be ready as the next comment.
Awesome. Thank you. Good day, Maria Bolton Hubert. I'm up here, or down here rather, from Orange County. So I'm here today to demand that now the state, the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, start planning of the storage, the treatment, and movement of water south of Lake Okeechobee in the EAA. We need the EAA planning now and not in 2020. We have a problem here. This is a statewide problem. All 67 counties need to be concerned and take ownership of this issue. The Everglades and Lake O belongs to all of us, not just the counties surrounding the lake. I live in Orange County, Florida, and yeah, a portion of my county, our water flows into Shingle Creek, into the Kissimmee River, and down here into the Everglades. We're all connected to what is happening. I still want the state to purchase the land south of Lake Okeechobee. I want that in order for there to be built a deep water reservoir to help restore the Everglades. We need to do this. Big Sugar needs to comply. I also want incentives created throughout our state in order to help folks update their septic systems, because we all know that's expensive. I am also concerned with what has happened to our Yes on One money that 75% of voters voted on. I will say this, local elections matter. I encourage everyone to look up who is running for their August 30th election, the primary, and who is running on the ballot for the November 8th presidential ballot. The deadline to register, by the way, is in a couple days for the August 30th election. You can actually get that information. It's public record. You can look up who contributed to each and every one of these candidates. And I'm tired of people being bought out by big business in this state. They do not represent the people then. And I am talking to some people that are in this room, and I do not care. I am tired of what has been happening to our state, and we need to take it back. We need representation, and we live in a democracy. Again, find me if you need help. You can Google search it. You just basically search your county. For example, where I live, you Google search Orange County Supervisor of Elections. There's a list of candidates, and they have to file quarterly and all these different time frames with their expenditures and their contributions. I encourage everybody, look and see who is bought and paid for. It's public record. Share it all over social media. Enough is enough. Thank you.
Thank you. Chris Nolan, and the next person up will be Elda Bass.
Good evening, how are you? Thank you, Dave, I appreciate the opportunity. I'd like to just share something with you because I'm a proponent of a lot of education. There's a lot of bits and pieces here, a lot of suggestions and recommendations. I'm going to ask if you have a pen and paper, write this down. I'm going to give you a website, www.algewheel.com. Algewheel.com. As bizarre and counterintuitive as it sounds, one of the things that we absolutely know, I, by the way, am a consultant for a company called One Water Group, and what I do is I identify the top scientific solutions worldwide for various problems in the environment. The very top solution, I contend, is at algewheel.com. It will solve many of the problems outlined here tonight. I'd like to share more information. Obviously, I'm limited on time. Matt, you're on the right track with the reservoirs north of the lake. We got to take it a little step further. And if any of you are interested, we'd love to speak with you about it, because you have solutions which are simple as daylight and green algae. You say algae solves algae? Yes, it does. And we have the system to do it. We created it for Disney 10 years ago. We created it for the Brookfield Zoo. Now we're doing it all over the world. Florida needs algewheel.com. I'd like you to look at it. And then any of you people that are leaders in this particular organization, in any of these organizations, we're free to come and sit down with our scientists and share with you the solutions that you're looking for. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Elda Bass?
She left.
And how about J.C. Bass?
She left.
Okay, so then we have Rebecca Bruner.
She left.
Okay, Robert Miller?
I'm okay, go ahead.
Okay. All right, David Bottomley?
No, I'm not speaking.
Okay.
I had
a yes check, so very good, sir. Gina LaBruno? Okay, and then after Gina is Ron Hamel? Hamel?
Hi. I just want to point out that 3 years ago, August 1st makes 3 years, that Governor Scott and Senator Mark Rubio were here addressing the same issue. He promised, well, first he blamed the feds for what has been occurring. He promised $40 million to resolve the issues, yet here we are today. So I just wonder, when the Army Corps and the people running this state are going to heed towards the issues that we continue to have. There is a lot of broken promises going on being led by our governor. And I'm not ashamed to say it either. It is embarrassing. And that's pretty much all I have to say. It's a sad situation, and we have to keep Florida waters safe. For us, we have to keep it safe. So, thank you.
Thank you. And Ron Hamel, I do appreciate you all trying to keep the 2 minutes. Thank you very much.
Yeah, Ron Hamel with Gulf Citrus Growers, and I'd like to commend the Corps and everybody for coming out for this this meeting tonight, because I think that storage throughout the system is extremely important, but I think the more we look north, all the statistics are pointing to storage north of the lake and throughout the system, but predominantly north of the lake to allow for more flexibility. They did a very good factual overview. I believe the South Florida Water Management District did it in conjunction with the Corps. And I'd urge all of y'all to pick that up and read it and look at the details. And we look forward to participating. And, you know, I wish you could speed this up. You know, this has been going on, the process, for over 20 years. And some of us were around when you started putting the Everglades Restoration Program together and developed the Yellow Book. And there's a lot of elements in that Yellow Book that are obviously technology won't allow for all those, but Storage, I think everybody agrees, storage is really key, and the more we can put north to keep it from moving into the lake, I think statistically it is the way to go.
Thank you very much. Appreciate that. Again, if you state the affiliation that you're with too when you come, Lisa Interlandi. And then the next after Lisa is Alan Stewart.
Lisa Interlandi with the Everglades Law Center. I want to thank the Corps for providing this opportunity for comment. I would urge you to possibly consider additional scoping meetings closer to the coast, because I think that there's a lot of people, to the extent that this project is intended to provide benefits from Lake Okeechobee discharges, I think that there's a lot of people on the coast who might choose to weigh in if there were meetings that were more conveniently located. So I would urge you to perhaps schedule additional meetings in areas that are convenient to the areas that are supposed to be benefited. I would like to second the suggestion that this project, the scope of this project, be expanded to include storage south of the lake. The EAA Reservoir Project has been languishing, and while a project implementation report, an EIS, was actually completed back in 2006, the project has not moved forward and, in fact, has been delayed. Planning not proposed to start until 2021. So we urge you to move that project forward. Our estuaries cannot afford to wait additional time for storage. The University of Florida study did recommend storage north of the lake. It also recommended storage within the Everglades agricultural area. In fact, significant quantities of storage, much more storage than is currently planned in SEP. So in order to stop the discharges, we need storage north of the lake, we need storage south of the lake. You know, for every bit of water that is stored and treated north of the lake before it's discharged, it has to be sent south. And once it's sent south and left and it leaves the lake, it has to be cleaned again before it can be sent to the Everglades. So we need a place within the Everglades agricultural area where we can store water and treat it so that it can be sent south, clean water to the Everglades. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Alan, and after Alan is Gary Ritter.
Hello, my name is Alan Stewart. Among other things, I'm a Navy Floridian. I was reared on the Indian River in the city of Cocoa. I'm an environmental engineer and a biologist, and I have been actively involved with the Lake Okeechobee project since 1979.
If any of you remember the interim action plan in 1979, well, I've been with it ever since. And one of the things I want to bring out, and by the way, I have no financial interest in any of the technologies I'm going to mention, but one of the things that I've been involved in over the years is the development of systems we call managed aquatic plants, where we use algae, water hyacinths, other aquatic plants to remove and recover and reuse nutrients associated with Lake Okeechobee. This is important, and we've done several projects with the district. And this technology is presently being used in every other county to help meet their TMDL requirements. The reason this is important is because we have huge stores of phosphorus in the lake, in the sediments, and in soils, and a lot of the aquatic plants that are sprayed every year and drift down to the bottom. In a recent presentation in Orlando, Dr. David Tomasco presented the facts related to this, and said that you could remove all of the loads coming into Lake Okeechobee, and this phosphorus in the sediments, this legacy phosphorus, will continue to send pollution to the estuaries in the south. It is important and critical that we not just remove phosphorus and store it in places like SCOs or in BMPs. We have to recover that phosphorus, we need to recycle it, and we need to reuse it. This would be a new agro-industry where aquatic plants would be the crop. It could create jobs, and over the long term, it could remove not only the incoming phosphorus, but also the legacy phosphorus. If you don't remove the legacy phosphorus, the disruption to our estuaries is going to continue. I wrote a letter in 1987 that said this, and I'd be happy to give you all a copy of that if you want it. But it continues to be true. Thank you.
Thank you. Gary Ritter. Next is Ben Butler.
Good afternoon, Gary Ritter with the Florida Farm Bureau Federation. First of all, I'd like to welcome you all to Okeechobee and our community here. I live here, a longtime resident. Got just a few points that I want to bring up. Number one, the Florida Farm Bureau Federation has been and continues to be very supportive of the Everglades Restoration Project and this Lake Okeechobee Watershed Project. Number two, we are in favor of completing projects within the planning area and looking for opportunities on existing state and federally owned lands. We support partnerships with agriculture whenever possible, including conservation easements, dispersed water management, water farming opportunities, in addition to addressing BMPs in the watershed that we've been doing for decades now. I'd like to also point out that, you know, this planning area, map's not up there, but it covers Okeechobee, Highlands, and Glades County. One of the things that has really not been discussed is what are the opportunities in the Upper Chain Lakes? And we would like to see more information, more scoping and planning in the Upper Chain Lakes to see if there are possible storage opportunities up there. To my knowledge, as long as I've been involved in the process, I have never, seen plan going on in the Upper Chain Lakes with the exception of the Kissimmee Restoration Project. Lastly, and I know this one's not going to be popular, but I'm going to say it anyways. We do not support additional land acquisition, especially that results in more losses of our state and country's food supply. I think that's a very, very critical. It's very important. And we really need to take this into consideration when we're doing this planning process. Thank you.
Thank you. Ben Butler, followed by Hillary Swain.
Thank you. Ben Butler. I'm a fourth generation farmer and rancher from Okeechobee County. I've lived here for 30 years in my 37 year life, the other 7 years in Gainesville. And I'm going to reserve most of my comments for email. I'm going to echo Gary Ritter's comments. I'm also a member of Okeechobee County Farm Bureau, and we understand the importance of agriculture. And for 30 years, what agriculture has done in the northern Everglades with our BMPs and the many projects, the many personal dollars, including my family, that have put into these projects, in addition to public assistance, has taken a toll on agriculture. And thankful that thankful that we are still here and still able to produce food for the rest of everybody else in the state of Florida. Again, I'll echo Gary's comments on the importance of agriculture and the importance of farmland and what good farms can do to help clean the water, especially in the northern Everglades. Thank you.
Thank you. Hillary Swain. And following Hillary will be Keith Pierce.
Hello, my name is Hillary Swain. I'm the director of Archbold Biological Station, which is an ecological research center just south of Lake Placid. We manage about 20,000 acres in this watershed. I first of all appreciate the fact that there is renewed emphasis on looking at the headwaters or the northern Everglades, so we're glad to be back in the eye again, glad to be back and engaged in the process. I think what I would really encourage you is looking back at the UF study, looking back at your own work, you know, looking at this headwaters watershed as not the 922,000 acres that you've designated, but really the 2.6 million acres that are in this watershed, you know, including 17% of it is the ancient sand ridges on the west of the watershed, ranches, rivers, ridge to river in this watershed. And I think we're making a mistake thinking of the watershed again as a 5-gallon bucket of water, and we're just messing around with the bottom 2 gallons. We have to look at the whole 5 gallons. We're not as compartmentalized as south of the lake. The lines on these maps are at best fuzzy. They're not straight lines that allow easy compartmentalization of the hydrology. And I think the other extraordinary thing about this watershed is, unlike south of the lake, only 22% of this watershed is either in public or conservation private lands. So we're going to have to think very differently about our strategies north of the lake, because we don't have the same opportunities that we have south of the lake with multiple rivers, many of them agricultural. And I think in some way, it gives us the chance to be very different and very imaginative north of the lake. So I'm looking forward to the suggestions you have, and I'll throw out a few of our own. Thank you.
Thank you. Keith Pierce, and then Joe Neeson will be next, if you'd like to work your way up to the front.
Hi, I'm Keith Pierce. I'm a fifth-generation rancher in Glades County. And I just read a recent report that was released by James Madison Institute. 5.5 million acres already belong to government agencies in South Florida alone. Another 3/4 of a million acres is under conservation easements. My question would be, why are we looking at purchasing more land? We need to be looking at utilizing funds to utilize the existing properties that are already in government ownership. Thank you.
Joe Neeson? No? Colleen Frost? Pass, okay. Betty Osceola? Thank you. And then Darlene Watford, I apologize if I didn't get that name quite right. Next. Watfall?
A lot of my statements are going to come in written bill with the organization that I'm a part of. But for myself as an individual who was able to grow up in the Everglades, family's been here before Florida was Florida, and also it's very sad to hear a lot of people talking about ownership of the land. You do not own this land. Mother Earth does. The Creator does. You're only leasing it. And it needs to be better taken care of by everyone. And we remember, our people say, when you point your finger, you have four coming right back at you. It's not just the court. It's not just the government. It's not the... It's everybody who is counting on that production and who is living here, breathing this air. Also, you need to remember, and the lady, one of the ladies before me mentioned it, she kind of got it a little bit. You are dealing with a living system. Just like you breathe, live, and die, it does the same thing. The water is not dead. The land is not dead. Your farmers know that, and you should know that. You are not going to control what the Creator does and what this water does. And the better you realize that, the more you can understand it. If you live and breathe it, you understand how this water works. You understand how the environment works. You're not going to learn it out of a book. You have to live it. And right now, a lot of the projects that I see, all you're doing is moving your crap to somebody else. And you're keeping it. That's basically what you're doing. And just like Mr. Stewart said, you have to remove that crap. Otherwise, it's going to stay there, and your septic tank that you're using the environment for is going to get full. That's all I have to say.
And then Al Perry.
I'm Dowling Watt with the Okeechobee City Council. Gary Ritter didn't tell you, but he's also with the Okeechobee City Council. I don't think he wanted to be associated with me, but thank you, Gary. We had a couple of other elected officials that came in. I appreciate every elected official that's here, because we catch a lot of flack sometimes for things we can't do anything about. Representative Gail Heller, we appreciate you being here, and Commissioner Jackie Thurlow-Lippisch with Sewell's Point, we appreciate you being here. Jackie's very passionate on the Indian River, and I'm sure we'll hear from her. I'd just like to say, I support your projects here. I'd like for you to consider a couple of things, and Gary touched on them, and Ben touched on them. First of all, you need to consider the economy, and I'm sure you will, and the agricultural land. Agriculture is very important to us, particularly here in Okeechobee. It's important to us all because we all eat. So it's very, very important to us. I'd also like for you to very strongly consider the conservation easements and water farming. I think that is the way to go rather than purchasing land, so I'd appreciate if you would consider those. Anything you do, and I'm kind of like Gary, I don't know that I'm in favor of purchasing more land south of the lake, and Jackie hates to hear that, but I don't know that I am. I would encourage you, encourage all of us to support the CERC projects that are currently the, what's it called, the integrated delivery schedule. That needs to be done, and we don't need to take the focus off of that. Unfortunately, the recent water quality problems on the coast have kind of taken the focus off of that, but we need to stay focused on that. And if we all worked as hard getting those projects funded as we do complaining about everything else, we'd be a lot further along in that process. I'd also want to strongly encourage you to consider the health of the dike, the Herbert Hoover Dike. Very important to all the communities around the lake, and I know you will, but I want you to strongly consider that. Thank you very much.
Mel Perry, followed by Rick Hartman.
Good evening. Thanks for hearing our comments tonight. My name is Al Perry. I'm the city manager of the city of Cooliston, and I want to commend you folks for finally focusing on north of the lake. You know, I want to remind some of the people in the audience that we hosted a peaceful rally about 3 years ago in Cooliston about the water releases, and we were singing that song loud and clear and didn't get any traction. And whoever's responsible for getting that traction out there, thank you. So the water storage north of the lake is very important to us. And I just want to say one thing. The quality of the lake is very important to us, too. Maintaining proper lake levels. And the reason for that is our local economy, our fishing economy, is just as important to us as yours is to you on the coast. And it's just at a different level, but it's just as important to us as yours is to you. Thank you.
Thank you. Rick Hartman, followed by Paul Siever. Okay, Paul Siever, are you still with us?
Yep, I'm here.
Okay, and then Steve Wheel, I believe.
I'm Paul from Palm Beach Springs Water Company, and we're distributors of electrochemistry equipment, and we can help clean up the phosphorus before it ever gets into the Lake Okeechobee without any chemicals, without leaving any negative footprint behind, and we can take it out of the soil. I forget what this gentleman says. So anyway, we can take it out of the water. We can also kill the cyanobacteria at the same time and do it without any chemicals. Thank you.
Okay, is Steve Wheel, then Shannon Larson.
Paul Siever just identified a major problem that you have at this moment in the lake that seems to be ignored here in this room. And that is, there's a major plague of the green algae bloom spreading. It's not only on the lake, but it's spreading to all the estuaries, it's spreading north, and it's spreading south. If you don't kill off the bacteria and do it soon, the whole lake will be full of it. It will be flooded with it. Right now, it's a plague, and everyone's talking about storing the water here and storing it there. This last gentleman just identified that they have equipment that will kill off that cyanobacteria. If you ever put your hand in it, you'll see the rash that you will get from it. The ability to kill off the bacteria, technology exists. It's being used all over the world except for here. It's 100% organic. It's natural. It just temporarily changed the molecular structure of the water, which kills off the bacteria. And after the bacteria is killed off, the water is pumped back into the lake, absolutely pure. In addition to that, the same equipment with a slight alteration also mines the phosphorus that's in the water, the legacy phosphorus that's been there for years and years, been deposited for a lifetime. And that legacy phosphorus will always plague the lake unless it's removed. Right now, it can be removed by electrolysis. All they do is mount this on big barges. They only take up about a foot of water, and as they go into 1 foot of water, or less even, or into the deeper water, they actually mine this phosphorus. It electronically, phosphorus has magnetic qualities, and those qualities will attach to their equipment by magnet. It's a magnetism that they grab whatever's on the bottom, plus they could do it at the headwaters. So you could stop the phosphorus from coming into the lake to begin with, You can mine and remove the phosphorus and then resell it. It'll mix in with the soil. It's got phosphate in it, but it's a different kind of technology. When you have phosphorus being mined on a dry, open land pit, that's one thing. But when it's in the water, it entails a different aspect of the science of removing phosphorus. This product and the technology is used all over the world, except here in the United States, for some reason. It was just never introduced. It was never caught on here. But they're now starting to use it in California. And Florida is the ideal place for it. Right here in Florida, you've got to get rid of that plague because it's spreading. You can store all the water you want, but all that water will be contaminated. You can't help it. It will be automatically contaminated. And here, they have a product and a piece of equipment and a technology that's 100% organic.
Shannon Larson with Ancient Trees. I'm neither for or against this project. I'm stating that because I don't think enough details have been given where the land is going to be and all the other questions I have going on in my mind. But I think with this project, it's essential that they create a citizens watchdog committee over this entire project. So we know where the money comes in and where it goes out and what it's being used for. We've all seen the Everglades restoration money. It ends up on study after study after study after study, and nothing ever happens. I don't want to see that happen again. We need to take control over this and watch it. I think it should involve a lot of local input, people that live in the areas that are going to be affected. I don't want to see, I think on-site visits must be done by the Corps, not just looking at the computers and saying, well, this can be here, or that can be there, or that can be there, or that can be there. That's what they do. That's what their studies do. They need to get out there and make sure that this system's going to work before they even try to implement it, or we're just going to be another 20 years behind. I think this whole thing can go a lot quicker. They have studies. They have material already that can be shortened down to 1 to 1, I think. I also feel that they need to get out of their STA boxes. There are other systems that have been mentioned today that are far better than the STAs. So they need to look at more innovative and systems that really work in the times that we're living in today. They're talking about they're going to do scoping more with the people. I certainly hope that they really do this and include the indigenous people also all the way through this. They're notoriously, especially independents, left out of the system. And I don't want to see that happen either this time. I think when the citizens are involved, we can identify the problems as they're occurring. You see them. Everybody knew in the beginning that that lake didn't need to be dammed. Many people spoke out about that, yet they did it anyway. People shouldn't be living there in the first place. So, I just thank you.
Okay. Irene, what else comes up? I'd just like to offer that real quick. There's, again, I appreciate you all trying to stick to the 2 minutes. Actually, there's a little green, yellow, red, and yellow means 30 seconds, so I will start doing that because we have 15 cards from the first go around. And again, we're really thankful for all the interest expressed. And we're doing a little shifting of gears based on some feedback from those that are still waiting out there. We're actually going to go ahead and do another presentation when these comment cards and bring the next group in, okay? So just want to keep that in mind. We have 15 cards left, so.
My name is Irene Gomes. I own a motel along the Indian River Lagoon. That's the most diverse, biodiverse estuary in North America. My family's been there since 1958. You're all worried about agriculture. I'm worried about the Florida economy, and we're based on tourism. And it's hurting, and it's hurting bad. Over the 4th of July, during that week, I've lost several thousand dollars. I'm also concerned about the quality of life. I have children and grandchildren. I'm concerned about what we're leaving the next generation. Everglades needs water. Florida Bay needs water. I mean, we need to get water moved south. I don't understand all this stuff where people are, I mean, isn't that obvious? The Everglades needs water. It also provides drinking water. I don't know. I get so upset when I talk about this because this has been my whole life, since I was 7 years old on the Indian River Lagoon. Like I said, the most biodiverse estuary in North America, and it's dying. And you need to care. You need to do something about it. We need to do something to save it before it dies, please.
Anna Ersalis, I believe. Apologize if I didn't do your last name justice. Anna. And next will be Kim Streiberg.
Yes, my name is Anna Bagalis. I just want to give you this photo. It actually looks like poop, but it's not. It's cyanobacteria. It's coming onto my property. It reduces the value of my property. Not only that, it's a cyanobacteria. You know, this blue-green algae, which is really it's a bacteria. Forget about the plant. It's more a bacteria. And when I have friends coming down from Ohio, Pennsylvania, New York, they're going to look at this and they're going to think it's poop. They're not going to think it's blue-green algae. And also, too, you say restore the estuaries. I'll give you this photo. You can give it to the governor, if you would. When you're saying restore, you have to have salt to restore. You can't have fresh water. I don't care if you clean it up 100 times. You're dumping fresh water on us. What is it doing? It's killing our seagrasses. Why do we say seagrasses? Seagrasses are salty, and that acts as a little nursery for our fish. And by killing those grasses, what you do is you're going to be putting more phosphates and nitrites into your water, and you're going to start it all over. The cycle goes on and on. And how long has this cycle been going on? 40, 50 years, 100? You know? I mean, it's ridiculous. And I always say it's God's salty water. It's man's hell, Okeechobee.
Thank you.
Kim?
And then Bobby Billy, with Sukis.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Kim Striver. I'm an 8th generation Florida native. And my phone's going to come up right now. Of course not. Sorry. I very much appreciate the agriculture and farming here as much as the coastal estuaries. It is all what makes Florida such an amazing place. I agree that slowing and cleaning water coming into the lake is necessary, but that is not going to stop the discharges east and west. Only a flowway south will do that. I want to make one thing very clear to everybody here tonight. The people and organizations taking part in the movement to purchase Everglades agricultural land are not doing it with the intention of putting farmers or ranchers around the lake out of business. Nor is it our intention to displace the residents of Belglade, Clewiston, South Bay, or any other community currently in place south of Lake Okeechobee. What we are fighting for is to restore the natural flow of clean water south to the River of Grass. It needs to replenish the aquifer. We only need a small portion of EAA land to clean and convey water south. A contract was signed in 2008 that allows the state to purchase land at fair market value. Funds exist due to the passing of Amendment 1. The contract expires in 2020. That's why they want to hold off until 2021. What we need is the political will to get that done before the contract is up. We all have to work together and do our part to clean our water, but so do our state leaders and governing boards.
Did you know the DEP and ERC, both governor-appointed, approved higher levels of carcinogens in our groundwater today? They will now allow higher levels of benzene and other chemicals used in the fracking industry. Is that what you want for your grandchildren? It's not what I want.
Bobby Billy.
Thank you. I'm the 15th generation since the beginning of creation. It looks so sad to see the people rely on the money, not by life. And you can't eat money. You can't drink money. And you can't create the food. But people manipulate so long, and they think it's God now. And we need money to wake up before it's too late. It's already too late. What things we see, the Mother Earth we call, we understand, indigenous people understand her, that God created us out of the earth. That's why we call it the Mother Earth. When you cut yourself, it bleeds. So when you cut out, it bleeds. It's simple. It's not difficult. You don't have to be a scientist to understand that. You're killing yourself. You're killing your future generation. We talk about water. We tell them the water managers and all the code engineers and everybody else, developers, all those people, you need to cover up those ditches. You can't live in the wetland complaining if you're underwater. You have brain, the way that God has gave you, simple, build your home, the higher land. Simple, be human. Be human being. To care for your future generation, to survival. That's what we all need to understand, that right now we're killing the future generation. Wake up. Tell water management, Army Corps of Engineers and Army, covered all the ditches. Plant the grass. It's the reason that God plant the grass in the water. Clean the water. That's what they're for. It's the reason why the God created the trees, to renew the air. It's concrete. It don't create the air. It don't drain, it don't regenerate anything. It just polluting, making pollution. In Florida, we don't used to have mountains, but now it's everywhere. Dump as high as 150 feet high now, everywhere. Think about all these. People need to slow down. If you want to live on God's creation, it's given to us to take care of it so we can pass it on to the next generation. Think about that. Thank you.
Thank you. Ira Brown. Ira. And Daniel Andrews.
Thank you for having this evening. My name is Ira Kaur. I'm the president of Government Services Trust and Biochar Technology. We did not expect to have only 2 minutes. We have brought tangible plans, some to kill the cyanobacteria, some to harvest the phosphorus, some to clean up the environment as well, and all 100%, as Mrs. Osceola was pointing out, 100% holistically pure, no chemistry, just good thinking, good brain power, cost effective, and we're hopeful that we can find a way to present this, not in this forum, because it's not fair to everyone who wants a chance to speak. But what we have spent the time to do and assembled real programs from real places, and it's proven. It's not pies in the sky.
And so we'd like to know where we can present this information. Is it Mrs. Ellinger?
Yes, and she's here today.
No, I understand that. I'm trying to cut this, my part short so everyone can speak.
Yeah.
But I want to be sure that we know where the focal point is.
That's the spot.
That's enough, then I'll shut up. Thank you.
Daniel Andrews, then Dr. Julie Bjornson.
Daniel Andrews from Captains for Clean Water. Thank you all for having us out here tonight. I'm a native Floridian and a fishing guide. Our estuaries are suffering right now in the Caloosahatchee River, the St. Lucie River, and Florida Bay. It's sad to me. I always try to leave the environment, my office, better than when I found it. But at this point, it's dying way faster than I ever imagined it would. The oyster bars and the grass lots where I grew up fishing no longer exist. Massive freshwater discharges of the Caloosahatchee and St. Lucie Rivers have destroyed what I thought was going to be the office for the rest of my career. Going down and seeing Florida Bay, where 50,000 acres of seagrass has died. That's an unbelievable amount of biodiversity removed. That takes decades to recover, not weeks, not months, not a season. I have a quote from the University of Florida Water Institute study I'm going to leave you with. The river of grass planting process demonstrated that there are several possible options involving combinations of deep and shallow storage, wet and dry flowways, coupled with STAs and enhanced conveyance that could provide significant benefit for both the estuaries and the Everglades, far beyond the benefits provided by the Kissimmee River Restoration, Indian River Lagoon South, C-43, restoration strategies and set projects. Achieving substantial reduction in late trigger discharges to the estuaries and substantial improvement toward the dry season Everglades demand target will require additional land between the lake and the Everglades protection area. I'd ask the Army Corps of Engineers and the South Florida Water Management District to keep that in mind when planning for storage north and south of the lake.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And next is Reverend Patricia Wallace.
Hi, I'm Dr. Julie Bjornson from Stuart, Florida. I'm involved in brain-based neurology research. Okay, is that better? Okay, my name is Dr. Julie Bjornson, and I'm involved in brain-based neurology research. You're all talking about the water stopping at the Everglades. It doesn't stop at the Everglades. I grew up in the Keys. I walked the sandbars. I snorkeled the reefs. The reefs were beautiful. The fish were beautiful. It was wonderful. The reefs are dying now. The reefs are bleached. That means they're dying. The fish are dying. My mother and I created a Florida Keys shell exhibit. They don't exist anymore. So the shell exhibit exists in Marathon. You can go see it at the Natural History Museum. But I'm really concerned about water quality. The reefs wouldn't be dying if the chemicals didn't have a half-life. If they just were, they would biodegrade when they tell you they're going to, but they don't. Those chemicals go right out into the ocean and they're destroying our reefs. They're destroying our water, they're destroying our way of life. I'm concerned about water quality. Lisa Alley mentioned low lake levels increase aquatic and invasive plants. Public records show high quantities of pesticides and herbicides are introduced into our water system to control these plants. They don't biodegrade. They have half-lives, long half-lives. With the development of more storage areas, will aquatic and invasive plants be a problem? And if so, how will you manage these plants? And how will you treat them? I would like to know, where can I find information on the chemicals used, the amounts used, and your treatment schedule? I am concerned. I am very concerned about what's happening with the amount of chemicals that are going in our water system. We talk about clean water. It doesn't mean you might take the phosphates out, but are you taking all the other chemicals out? We need to look at that as affecting our health. These chemicals, I'm involved in restoring citrus groves naturally. They're coming back. We have harvest now. We're reversing citrus greening naturally. It's these chemicals. We need to stop it. We need to have healthy food for our children so they can grow, develop, and learn and become productive citizens. Thank you.
Thank you. Patricia Wallace. And next is Commissioner Brian Culpepper.
Thank you for this opportunity to speak. My name is Reverend Patricia Wallace. I'm from Pahokee. I'm a lifetime resident of the city of Pahokee and the state of Florida. I am concerned that enough local people are at the table of decisions. If you don't live where I live, you don't know the impact of what your studies are doing to the residents of the city of Pahokee. I know that we live off the farmland, and farming is very important to our livelihood. To see a next generation of my children and grandchildren survive, you will impact us when water start flowing. So I heard one young lady said they have no intent of displacing people. Can we get a statement from the federal government, from South Water Management, from the Corps of Engineers, that any land they purchase, any water they release, will not replace displaced residents at Pahokee, Belleglade, South Bay, Okeechobee, Tourist, and Moorhaven around the lake? We touch the lake. I can walk out of my back door across the dike levee and I'm in the lake. So to get water to a southern part of the land, you mean you have to sweep me away. Don't sweep me away. Storm of 28 did enough that for us. We have enough impact from that. So whatever decision this body makes, please bring local people to the table. Bring young people to the table. Take the advice of some of these people who have products that will work. It seems that we have not tried what works. So do it. If the money is there, use the money on what works and stop researching things that you know are not going to work and going to delay the process. I pray that you will move forward, use research that has been tested, and do not displace people with the releasing of water. Thank you.
Molly Sula Gardner. And then Carson Turner.
Mr. Tipple, thank you for the warm welcome tonight. I'd like to thank you for that. And also Mr. Collins, I don't know if he's here tonight still or if he's left, but I wanted to thank the Water Management District for sharing the facts, for publishing the facts. I also wanted to thank them for resolution number 2016-0711, which really asked for the federal government to complete the work of the Herbert Hoover Dyke. It is critical for our community. I'm not sure if you, I know you mentioned it, but my name is Molly Gardner, and I'm a Coulson City Commissioner, and I am concerned. Over the years, I've seen our community tossed to and fro by every single statement that's made about Lake Okeechobee, by every single demand for flood these communities, every single demand to take the land. It has to stop. We're all in this together. We love our communities. We love our farmers. We love living on the tips of Lake Okeechobee. Just like this Reverend just said, I can walk out my door and go up on the levee and see sunrise and sunset on Lake Okeechobee. And you don't think we're proud of our lake? We are proud of our lake. And that's why tonight I am here. I want to please, please encourage the Corps of Engineers to continue with this project and look at the land north of Lake Okeechobee. It is important for water quality, it is important for water storage, it is important to save Lake Okeechobee, and it is critical, critical that the funding be used to complete the projects that have already been approved by the state and federal government and get the projects done so that we can have a cohesive system from the north, the south, the east, and the west. It needs to be done, and it needs to be done quickly. Quit wasting money. I agree with you. Quit wasting money on other things. Focus on the projects and get it done.
Thank you. Carson, and then next is Terry Torrens.
Thank you very much. Commissioner Turner from Henry County. A lot of comments, a lot of things I disagree with being stated here tonight, a handful of things I do agree with. I'll tell you, you know, for me, buying land is not an option. It's something that should be taken off the table. It's asinine. It's going to delay a tremendous amount of projects that are on the books that are going to create relief to these issues that we have, these deluges that we have. I've gone to D.C. the last 4 years in a row now with a handful of commissioners from across this entire state, from Orlando South. We've asked our senators and our congressional leaders to pass a word of bill. We were fortunate enough to get one done 3 years ago, I believe it was. There was a 7-year gap. I would ask everyone in this room to please reach out to their congressional and senatorial leaders and try to get a word of bill acted on. We need to revisit lowers right now. The current plan for the Corps of Engineers is to wait until 2020. I don't know what forecast that they couldn't model with the past few years that we've had, the past 10 years. Go back and look. We've had crazy weather. We've been in these rooms where the temperature's been hot, no pun intended, where everybody's pointing fingers, and we've seen this happen time and time again. Corps of Engineers, I challenge you, don't wait till 2020. Move that ball down the field, get it going. Look at Lord's right now, there's movement in there to store on the lake. Commissioner Greed from Osceola County, she and I serve on the Lake Okeechobee Coalition together. She's a champion. I'm excited to hear about looking at possibilities up on the northern end of the lake, in the chain of lakes, and I think the Osceola County is a willing partner. Terry Torrens is here, and I know she's going to speak to that as well, but that's a definite option that needs to be vetted. And I just want to say that buying land south, not an option. It takes our eyes off the prize of getting projects done. Economy to a scale, you all, when you come out to Lake Okeechobee, I challenge you to come and visit with me in Clueston, America's sweetest town. I was born in Pehokee. Come on with it. Come down. We'll go on a horseback. We'll go on an airboat. We'll go on a class boat, whatever you want to do. And we'll talk about it until the cows come home, literally. And we'll feed the Brahmas, the long ears out there. And you'll see what we're about. And we're the best conservationists on the planet. Look at the water that's coming off of our fields. Look at what's happening. And I say we collective. I don't grow cane, okay? It's not how I make my living. I make my living on bridges that go up and down with the Florida Department of Transportation. But I'm here on my time tonight. And I challenge you all to come down to Clueston, Pahokee, Belgrade. Check us out sometimes. You'll be amazed at the people and what we're about. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Terry Torrens and then Cheryl Dries. Reeve, I'm sorry.
Hi, Terry Torrens, Natural Resources Manager, Osceola County. I came down tonight with my Commissioner Cheryl Reeve to talk about looking at the project area and being possibly included in the solution. We're really glad to see that the Corps and the Water Management District are getting together to address the problems that we currently are having with Lake Okeechobee and the water releases in Osceola County and the upper chain of lakes. Isn't included in the project footprint in terms of the study and scoping. So we're just here saying that we're interested, we're willing partners, we think we have potential options up in the upper Cassini Basin, and we would just like to be a part of the plan. So thank you, and I'll introduce my commissioner, Cheryl Greer.
Cheryl Greer, I apologize. And then Representative Heather Fitzenhagen will be next.
Hello, Cheryl Greer. I'm the Vice Chairwoman for the Osceola County Commission. And I would first like to thank the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers and South Florida Water Management for hosting this public comment opportunity on this most important project. I've already submitted a letter, so I won't bore you through that, but I want to say a couple other things. The headwaters, as most of you know, start in Orange County and flow through Osceola County, but these northern areas, unfortunately, are not included in the project boundary and planning areas. We understand that the water in our county flows south, and its quantity and its quality are part of the overall problem. However, Osceola County is also willing to be part of that solution. Aquifer storage and recovery would be a great fit in the Upper Cassini watershed. It would be seen as favorable in the Central Florida Water Initiative to increase capacity in an area with limited water supply. We have large agricultural tracts that would be suitable in both location and function in our southern portions of our county that could house large storage facilities. We're not asking for priority. We would just like to be included in the feasibility study and the project boundary. The purpose of this project is to improve quality, quantity, timing, and delivery of water. It's been stated that we need to have storage north of the lake as part of the solution, and I could not agree more. It has been stated that this project is a system-wide project, yet it excludes the Upper Cassini Basin. Osceola County can be part of the solution if we are invited to be part of the process. Please allow us this opportunity. I thank you.
Thank you. Representative Fitzenhagen. And then next will be Dennis Duke.
Thank you very much. I'm Representative Heather Fitzenhagen. I represent Lee County, Fort Myers, and my community is suffering with the water releases and the discharges from Lake Okeechobee, and that's why I'm here today. Folks, we are in a crisis. We're in a crisis of economics, we're in an environmental crisis, and we're now in a health crisis as a result of what's happening with discharges from the lake. But I am not here to play the blame game. I am here to be open to any kind of solutions, but I have to say that what we're doing now isn't fast enough and it isn't enough. All these things discussed are great ideas, and I think we should follow through with them, but it's not happening quickly enough. And it is not including a flowway south through the EAA, which I believe we need, and I believe the science supports that, from the University of Florida study. Thank you. So we need to find a way to do that. Now, people talk about we can't afford it, we don't have the money. Well, Amendment 1 money was designated for that, number one. And number two, who's to say that the money, that the land might not be donated? Maybe somebody wants to donate some land that's south of the lake. Or maybe they would like to swap some land with some other land in another area of Florida to try to find a solution. I don't think we should take any solutions off the table, but we need to resolve this now, because people in this room won't even be alive by the time we get through with some of these projects. We will not be alive to see the results. So thank you very much. I appreciate your time.
Good evening, I'm Dennis Duke. I'm with the United States Department of the Interior. I've been in Everglades for quite a while. I was with the Corps before that, working on this project. Applaud the efforts of the Water Management District and the Corps of Engineers in hosting this public meeting to start gathering information for this process. We look forward to working with them to address some of those problems that Newton Cook raised earlier regarding endangered species. Yes, we do have those. We want to wipe out a species as we try our restoration. But we believe that restoration will lead to the betterment of all those species, as well as the human environment. And just backing up for a moment, I don't want to put this too lightly, but when somebody said somebody promised $40 million for this, look at the table that Matt went through a while ago and the projects that are currently underway. I mean, we've got the Kissimmee River restoration, and it's three-quarters of a billion-dollar project that's going to capture some of the water, slow it down before it gets to the lake. This project is another piece. Newton was talking about how small, the effect of this is. Keep in mind that all these projects are designed and planned to work together. We've got this project coming on to provide storage to help capture and slow the water down coming in to Lake Okeechobee and clean it up before it actually gets in the lake. Because you're right, we have a huge legacy phosphorus problem and nutrient load in the lake that needs to be addressed. That's in part of the planning down the road someplace. On the east and west coast, we have the C-43 reservoir and the C-44 reservoir, both under construction by the Corps of Water Management District. Going south, we have the Central Everglades Project, $1.9 billion project that's awaiting authorization in Congress to start moving that water south. We have Tamiami Trail Next Steps, the Mild Waters Project. Each of those, nearly $500 million or more to help provide the flowway to get the water south. We appreciate this. This is just another piece of that overall puzzle. And we really appreciate adding aqua storage and recovery to this project. Before, my history with this has been mainly focused on surface storage and SCAs. They consume land. With aqua storage and recovery, we can reduce the footprint of those projects and store the water underground. And we need lots of storage. So we strongly support this and look forward to working with you to help these issues with endangered species and other issues that pop up as we go. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dennis. So before I make a few closing remarks, what we're going to ask everyone to do is to exit from the back door, because we have people waiting out in the lobby that they're going to come in through that door over there to fill in as you leave. But appreciate the opportunity to present the information. Thank you for your time that you've given the study team in this project kickoff. Again, all comments will receive equal consideration. If you have any additional information or comments or input, again, those addresses and emails by August 12th. Again, thank you, everyone, and have a safe trip home.